Well, today again, for the exam going students, this is the class and we'll go ahead with the case. Okay, so we have Dr. Darshan and Dr. Praveen from Cochin and Pune. All right, so this is a 52 years old male presented with chief complaints of right flank pain off and on for last 3 to 6 months. So moderate in intensity, not radiating, just dull aching. There are no aggravating factors, but sometimes pain becomes quite severe and that time he has to take painkiller. Otherwise, usually he doesn't take any medication. The last 1 month he is having vomiting off and on, irrespective whether he is having pain or not. So these are the complaints which he has come with. Okay, so now Darshan, what is in your mind?
Sir, we are looking at the pain and history. I would like to look for the complaint associated with the pain, as you have described the pain and the associated complaint, like he has any fever, any lower urinary tract symptoms. He has a
power. Okay, so tell all the things that comes in your mind in the history which you want to ask. You want to ask about fever. Okay, what else you want to ask?
Sir, any history of lithuria? Or any history of pus or in the urine or burning micturition, sir? Sir, any past history of any urological intervention? And any history of trauma, sir? And is there any hematuria was there or not, sir? And
so you want to ask about hematuria, lithuria, pyuria, then fever, trauma.
Yes.
And then any past history of any interventions?
Yes, sir.
Anything else you want to ask?
Sir, any mass is, he has felt any mass in the flank region or not, sir?
So that, if it is there, he will complain of it. Very fact that he has not come out with that, obviously he has not felt any mass or anything. Otherwise, he would tell that for last 2 months or 3 months or this, I can feel some mass.
Yes, regarding pain, sir, I required this also.
Okay, Praveen, what is there in your mind? Are you happy with whatever has been asked by him, or you want to add anything to it?
Sir, I would like to add whether the patient has a facial puffiness, pedal edema, or a patient has a cough, breathlessness, hemoptysis, any history
Why
of
are
weight
you
loss.
Asking all this?
Sir, since this is a pain in the right flank, on and off since 3 to 6 months.
Yeah.
So, probability of I'm keeping a probability of one is stone, second is tuberculosis, and third is malignancy also in my mind.
Malignancy, okay, all right, okay. So, these are the gross things which you have to ask. And whenever there is a pain or whenever there are any symptoms, every time you have to ask about the lower tract symptoms. Any patient, any urological symptoms, any urological patient, it is very much necessary whether to ask about the lower tract symptoms, because that can get associated with any of the problems. So whether he has any increased frequency, whether he has to strain for passing urine, whether there is any hesitancy, urgency incontinence, so all these things will come. How it is relevant when there is a history primarily of a pain and just the vomiting, how the lower tract history is important and how it is relevant. Praveen?
Yes, sir. There can be a malignancy in the bladder obstructing the ureteric orifice, which can cause the loin pain.
Okay, anything else?
And even the passage of blood and blood clots.
Yeah, that he has asked, hematuria, lithuria he has asked. Now, what I'm asking you is that in any urological disease, how come lower tract symptoms are very important? Why you should ask for those symptoms in almost every case of urology? Darshan, what is your take on that?
Sir, I want to rule out any lower urinary tract causes of hydronephrosis also, like any lower urinary stricture or any mass occluding the VU junction, or as patient is old, but there I would also like to rule out any VUR or primary obstructive mega ureter, sir.
So basically, any urological problem, whether you told about the stone, whether it is tuberculosis, whether it is malignancy, whatever this, it has to have some bearing on the lower tract symptoms. In presence of lower tract symptoms, all these things are relevant. And in absence of lower tract symptoms, there is a different information which or inference which you have to get. So lower tract symptoms, even if there is a simple urinary tract infection, simple pyelonephritis, all this will somehow affect the lower tract symptoms. So it is important that you ask for history of lower tract symptoms. Okay?
Yes.
Okay, so this patient has history of hematuria in the past. It was just a mild tinge, occasional. He is not sure as to how frequently it is, but 2-3 times maybe he has passed blood tinge urine. No fever, no trauma, no difficulty in passing urine. He has loss of appetite for 3-4 months, no loss of weight, and he has got some weakness. But otherwise, no hemoptysis, no past interventions, no pyuria, no lithuria, nothing.
Yes.
So what next you want to ask? So all those questions and doubts which you have in mind, all of them are answered. And the only positive negative history is that he has got loss of appetite, weakness, and some hematuria. So anything else you want to ask or you want to go for examination?
We want to ask whether the patient is hypertensive, diabetic,
okay, any history of
any past history of tuberculosis.
Diabetes, hypertension, tuberculosis. Okay, good.
Yes,
very nice.
And whether he is taking any anticoagulants for any heart illness.
Okay, so any medications? Medicines taken is very important. So hypertension,
personal,
diabetes is very good. Medication,
yes,
is very good.
Whether he is a smoker, alcoholic.
Okay.
And how is his bladder habit? Whether there is any history of decreased urine output, anything?
Yeah. So that is all okay.
And
so
family.
So addictions are important. Family history. What is relevant?
Any history of a stone in the family, or any renal history of renal failure in the family, or any history of malignancy related death in the family?
Okay, any similar complaints in the family is important. What else?
History wise, I can cover the questions.
History wise, everything is okay. Are you not interested in asking the occupation?
Yes, sir. Occupation is.
How it is relevant in this case?
Sir, if it is a urothelial malignancy, then the occupation becomes important in whether he's working in dyes, fumes industry, nailing, and
okay. That is one more thing. And any personal history of anything else you want to ask? Whether he is married, whether he is not married, whether he has children, how it is relevant in this case? Does it have any bearing? Just write plantar pain and this history. So how come his family background is relevant?
So if he has any family history of renal malignancy, and if it is running, and if his sibling is having, or his brother is having, then it becomes
okay. All right. So let's come to that little later. But he is married, 2 children, one boy. He is hypertensive. He is taking medications, but he's not been investigated. He has a history of family problem of in mother 10 years back. His mother died. And sister is normal. Okay, so on examination, anything else you want to see?
Blood pressure is raised. Pedal edema.
He is hypertensive.
Yes.
There is no edema. There is no pallor. Pallor is present. Otherwise, no edema. Feet. No enlarged lymph nodes. BP is slightly borderline high. Pulse is okay.
Yes. Any facial puffiness is there?
No puffiness. No edema. Feet.
Okay. Yes.
Any general examination, what you want to see?
Any performance, his performance status. Yes.
Performance status is good.
Yes.
Okay, so that's very important.
Systemic examinations.
Okay, so on examination, if both kidneys are palpable. Now, whatever is written here, are you happy with it or it is adequate, it is not sufficient? Want to know something more than this?
Pertaining to the mass, any tenderness is there over the palpable lesion? Any
Okay, so
increase
any
in
tenderness?
yes,
Yeah. What else?
and how is this bladder palpable or not?
Okay, bladder you want to see. Okay.
And on external genitalia, hernia orifices.
Okay, so that is okay. What I want to come to you is that whenever there is a kidney which is palpable, what are the things which you should describe in exam? Suppose there is a kidney lump.
Yes.
What are the things which are to be described and what is the relevance of each? Let us come to that.
Yes.
Now, what is written here is that it is palpable. How do you describe how much is the enlargement of the kidney?
Finger bridge below the costal margin.
So always write down when you are describing in the exam, when you are describing a kidney lump, quite often you will get the kidney lump patient. So you have to describe either two finger, three finger, four fingers, or you can describe in a centimeter. Quite often the students, they say no, kidney is palpable and they don't describe how much is, because examiner doesn't get idea what actually, how big is the lump. So you must describe. Once it is quite big, then you have to say how much centimeter it is extending below the costal margin, whether it is crossing midline, whether it is not crossing midline, whether it is going up to the iliac fossa. All these things should be described. So that is about the extent of the lump. First and foremost is the warmth and tenderness and renal angle fullness. Okay. So when you are describing the kidney lump, these are the things which you must see. How you check the renal angle fullness?
Sir, in
What do you
the
mean by renal angle fullness?
lumbar triangle, whether the quadrant both side is symmetrical, and if it is bulged in the renal angle in the lumbar region, we'll see, sir,
Right.
from
So
the behind.
you have to see from
Behind,
behind,
yes.
and typically the renal. Even if the kidney is not palpable, if there is an enlargement of the kidney, not sufficient enough to be palpable, you will find there is some fullness in the renal angle. Because
Yes.
as kidney enlarges, first thing is that renal, that angle fullness comes in, then kidney further enlarges, then it becomes palpable under the costal margin, and then it enlarges in size. Okay. So if you say, if you see from behind and say that there is a renal angle fullness, it has got bearing. That means you are suggesting that there is probably enlargement of the kidney, even though kidney is not palpable. Okay. So that is the first thing. Then, of course, you have to see for the tenderness and the local warmth. Sometimes, if there is a tender pyonephrosis or perinephric abscess, you will find that there is a local warmth and there is a tenderness. So that has to be described. Once you describe that, then the kidney lump typically extend, and then what else you want to see? The surface.
Surfaces.
Surface is what is written here is that well-defined margin
Margin.
and irregular
Irregular.
surface.
Yes.
So what are the different surface which, how do you describe kidney lump surface?
So it can be a smooth surface and smooth surface or irregular surface it can be, sir. And
Right.
on margins can be well defined or ill
No,
defined.
we are coming only to surface.
Yes, smooth
Okay,
surface.
so any kidney lump, the kidney lump can be big iatrogenesis, it can be malignancy, it can be polycystic kidney, it can be cystic disease, it can be tuberculosis where it is enlarged. can be Peuge obstruction, it can be a stone which is causing non-functioning and enlargement of the kidney, HGPN. So all these things, the surface will be different. So surface, typically you have to describe that it is a smooth surface, which implies that whatever enlargement which has happened is a uniform hydronephrosis. If it is an irregular surface, then it, you know that actually the enlargement of the kidney is not uniform. Probably there is at some point the cortex is good, at some point the cortex is thinned out. That is the implication of the irregular surface. Suppose the surface is a nodular surface. The other description can be a nodular surface, which implies that you can actually, when the kidney is palpable, you can actually see multiple nodules, which can be typically seen when you can see that you have multiple nodules in the kidney surface.
So it is malignancy.
Correct. So in malignancy, you can have multiple nodular nodules which are felt on the surface. Okay. Okay. So that is about surface description. Then what else? How do you describe margins? What do you mean by margin?
The palpable margin is uniformly well defined, or there is any irregularity in the margins? Ill-defined.
No. So it can be well defined or it can be ill-defined. Now, what do you mean by ill-defined and what do you mean by well-defined?
Well-defined is, sir, mass which is not continuous with the surrounding surface, so its margin are well-defined. So benign lesions will be a well-defined margin.
Okay. And when you can ill-defined margin?
When mass is diffused and involving, sir, surrounding structure or anything, sir, other than organ.
No, what do you mean by surrounding structure? You mean to imply that it is a malignancy which has got ill-defined margins?
Yes, sir. Our locally advanced malignancy will have a ill-defined margin, sir.
Okay. See, there are two things. First of all, when you are describing the margin of a kidney lump, you have to say that kidney is felt, or say, for example, a kidney felt on the right side. All the margins, you have to say whether it is the lateral margin, medial margin, and inferior margin. Upper margin you can't describe in kidney lump. So first thing you have to say that all margins are well defined, and they are so well defined margin means there is a clear cut margin. Ill defined margin means what? It is, you can't really make out. It is merging with the surrounding structure. Now where you will get that? When you have an advanced malignancy, where you will not be able to see clear-cut margins. And secondly, the most common thing is that when the kidney is very flabby, you really can't see the well-defined margin. If you have a kidney lump which is palpable and it has got a soft or cystic consistency with well-defined margin, which means that it is a 10 cystic swelling or 10 hydronephrosis. But if you say that kidney is just palpable, and the consistency is soft, but it doesn't have the well-defined margin. Margins are ill-defined, which means that it is a very very soft or very flabby type of kidney. Okay, kidney can be enlarged, the tense hydronephrotic kidney, or it can be a flabby which is enlarged. Okay, so it has got implications from the diagnostic point of view. Okay, then next comes is that movement. Remember, any kidney lump you have to describe in a particular format: surface, margin, consistency, and mobility. Okay, so we have seen surface, we have seen margins, we have to, then is a consistency. Now, what do you mean by consistency?
So it is uniformly soft in consistency, or there is area of firm and hard area also.
Okay. And what else? What else can be the description?
Tense or flabby. Hydronephrosis.
Flabby cannot be the consistency. Consistency means consistency has to come in the particular description. So consistency, as we know from the MBBS days, that it is either it can be soft, firm, or hard. Correct? soft consistency can be a soft or it can be a cystic. Cystic also is a soft, but then it is called as cystic swelling. So cystic kidney lump can be a soft, but it can be a cystic, which means that it is a soft consistency, but it is a cystic, which you can palpate and then identify whether it is a cystic or not. Okay. So typically in a 10 Saturn nephrotic kidney, you can have the cystic consistency, right? So firm consistency, of course, you know that any kidney which is enlarged, as we saw that is a multiple nodules parenchymal thickness, it can be firm consistency, and it is a hard, obviously in the malignancy it can be hard. So consistency, when we are describing, there cannot be anything else. It can be soft, firm or hard. Soft can be again soft, or it can be soft cystic. Okay, now next is surface margin consistency and then mobility. Now what do you mean by mobility in a kidney lump?
So whether the kidney is bilotable and or bimanually palpable.
Okay. So what do you mean by bilotable?
So bilotability
is the inference of bilotable.
Bilotability is when the kidney is moderately enlarged and we try to push from one side, it comes and hits the other hand, surface of the other hand. So that is bilotable.
What does it imply? What does it imply from the clinical point of view when you are describing that, okay, kidney is bilotable? What the implication it has got in diagnosis, making a differential diagnosis?
One is that the enlarged kidney is not fixed to the surrounding structures.
Okay. Okay, what else? So that I agree. What else?
If anterior and posterior both are, if pushing from posterior and hitting anteriorly, then it is a retroperitoneal structure that implies, sir.
No, retroperitoneal is not identified like that. It can be intraperitoneal structure, which can be bilotable. Retroperitoneal structure, you have to make the patient in the prone and this position where it will disappear. So we are not going into that differentiation. We are not interested. Once you are MS, we assume that everything is known to you. But in the kidney lump, what does bilotable mean? So bilotable kidney means that it has got the adequate mobility, which implies that it is not adherent to the surrounding structure. And second most important thing is that any tissue or any lump which is bilotable means it has got a pedicle. Unless there is a pedicle, there cannot be a bilotability. Okay. So this is to differentiate this from other lump. Once the kidney is bilotable, which means that it has got a pedicle, it confirms that it is a kidney lump. And secondly, it is still not adherent to any surrounding structure. Okay. So what is about the mobility? In a kidney lump, to describe the mobility, there are two things which you have to describe. One is bilotability, and secondly, movement with the respiration. Okay. So if these two moments are there, that means it is a mobility is described. So any kidney lump, or for that matter, any lump, you need to describe in this particular format only. So in exam, once you get the kidney lump case, the description when you are describing to the examiner, you have to create an impression to the examiner. These are the tips I'm giving for appearing for exam. If you describe in a very haphazard way, the examiner doesn't get impressed. But if you describe in a proper flow, in a proper format, say for example, if you want to say describe the kidney lump, then you can say that on the local examination, there is no tenderness or warmth. There is no fullness in the renal angle, or there is a fullness in the renal angle. Right side kidney is palpable about 4 centimeters below the costal margin. It has got well-defined margins on the lateral, medial, and inferior surface. The margins are well-defined. The surface is smooth, cystic. The kidney is moving well with respiration, and it is palatable. So which means that you have described surface margin, consistency, mobility, everything. In just 1 minute, you can describe everything, all right? So it doesn't take much time. So, okay, so in this case, this is what is the description, all right? Bladder is not palpable, genitals are normal, everything is normal, okay? So now, what is your differential diagnosis? Let us come to that. You have seen these complaints. He's come with the flank pain, vomiting, weakness. There is a pallor, there is a weakness, and there's a loss of appetite. And this is on examination. So what is your differential diagnosis?
My first differential diagnosis would be, sir, polycystic kidney disease.
Okay. What else?
Bilateral enlarged kidney due to hydronephrosis.
Due to what? Hydronephrosis is not the differential diagnosis. Hydronephrosis is like saying he has got fever. Hydronephrosis is okay, I accept. But what is the cause of hydronephrosis? He has come with the pain, he has come with the weakness, he has got occasional hematuria and vomiting. You can't have only one diagnosis. You have to have differential diagnosis, and that too, it has to logically fit into the complaints and examination. So what else you can fit all these complaints into?
Family history is also for bilateral renal cell carcinoma.
Bilateral renal cell carcinoma, okay. So how common is the bilateral renal cell carcinoma to the extent that the both kidneys are become palpable?
No, very rare, sir, but still family
so don't
history
say, is there. Yeah, so don't say rare things.
Yes.
Bilateral hydronephrosis, so where you can get bilateral hydronephrosis? Because it is fitting. It has got a well-defined margin, irregular surface. He has got soft consistency, he has got pain, he has got vomiting, he has got weakness, and you say that it is a bilateral hydronephrosis. So where it is fitting?
Lower urethric calculus.
Everywhere. Why you are saying lower urethric? It can be a kidney stone, it can be upper urethric stone, it can be bilateral stones with bilateral hydronephrosis with the palpable kidney. So that is very common. He has got a pain. He has got weakness. It could be just a borderline high creatinine with palpable lump. So that is, everything is fitting. He has got occasional hematuria. So all symptoms and signs are fitting into bilateral hydronephrosis, probably due to stones. And once you say that there can be bilateral hydronephrosis in a 52-year-old male, there can be several causes of bilateral hydronephrosis. What are the other causes that also can be kept as differential diagnosis? So what are the likely causes of bilateral hydronephrosis with such presentation in a 52-year-old male? Stone, you have said, so that I accepted. It is perfectly all right. What else can be the presentation like this? Think of bilateral hydronephrosis.
Lower urinary tract pathology, like a large mass or any outlet obstruction or ureteric strictures.
Okay, so ureteric stricture, right. So that is okay. Ureteric stricture is not the outlet problem. That is the reason that whenever you have the outlet problem, it can cause bilateral hydronephrosis, which can be palpable, but if you have to have bilateral hydronephrosis, then yes, you have some lower tract symptoms. So that's the reason why in every case, it becomes ultimately very important to ask the lower tract symptoms. So he has no lower tract symptoms. So outlet problem causing such bilateral hydronephrosis, palpable kidney, is very unlikely. Ureteric stricture, okay, I can accept it. What can be the cause for the ureteric stricture? In a 52-year-old male, no previous intervention, and whatever the history.
रिपीटेड पैसेज ऑफ स्मॉल कैलकुलाई, और
ओके नॉट
बायलैटरल
रियली
यूरेट्रिक
बट
कैल्कुलस और ट्यूबरकुलोसिस कैन बी वन ऑफ द कॉज।
सो ट्यूबरकुलोसिस कैन बी वन ऑफ द कॉज. पेशेंट कैन हैव ट्यूबरकुलोस एक्सपोजर इन आवर कंट्री. ट्यूबरकुलोसिस एक्सपोजर इज वेरी कॉमन एंड देन विद द डिसेमिनेटेड ट्यूबरकुलोसिस पेशेंट कैन कम प्रेजेंट विद द बायलैटरल यूरेट्रिक स्ट्रक्चर. नॉट नेसेसरली एवरी टाइम द ब्लैडर हैज टू गेट अफेक्टेड and that can be one of the presentation with palpable kidney. Okay, what else it can be?
Bilateral UPJ obstructions.
Bilateral PUJ, so that is also possible. Now patient can have the asymptomatic, you know that quite often the PUJ obstruction can present at 40 years, 50 years. Sometimes they come at 60 years with non-functioning kidney. So it is possible that it is a bilateral PUJ obstruction, which has been remained asymptomatic, and now for whatever reason, it has become symptomatic. Okay, what else it can be? So it can be anything because of the obstruction into the pelvic lateral system. So that obstruction can be stone, obstruction can be stricture, obstruction can be tuberculosis. Obstruction can be bilateral obstructive megaureter, can be anything. The other thing is that obstruction can be because of the external compression. So if there is any retroperitoneal fibrosis, if there is anything, patient can have some backache which he may not give relevance. They get adjusted to that, and it has got bilateral hydronephrosis, and it has presented with this sort of a complaint. Okay. So when you are describing, when you get the case like this, these are all things which can actually fit into the your history and examination findings, right? Okay. So now what next? How will you investigate?
For this patient, I would like to have, sir, hemogram, creatinine, and the urine routine examination, sir.
All right. Okay. So this is the 9.5 hemoglobin. Total count is 6,900. BUN 77, creatinine is 4.3, and urine shows 1 plus protein, 4 to 5 pustules, and 8 to 10 RBC. No granular cast, no hyaline cast, nothing. 1 plus protein, that's it.
USG abdomen pelvis, I would like.
You want to have USG abdomen and pelvis. Okay. So this is the this is which kidney? This is the left kidney. This is the right kidney. I can understand that static pictures may not be representative, but right kidney is enlarged 14 by 12 centimeter, multiple cysts all over the kidney. PC system is seen and dilated, mild to moderate hydronephrosis. Upper ureter is also dilated. Parenchyma not well appreciated. Left kidney enlarged, again same. Multiple cysts all over the kidney. No stones, PC system not identifiable. Bladder partially full and normal. So what does it mean?
This patient is having the right side hydronephrosis with the cyst, multiple cysts. And ureter is not traceable up to the lower ureter, and left is a multiple cystic kidney. So I would like to have a plain CT abdomen of this patient to rule out any lower ureteric pathology on the right side. Sir.
You want to rule out the lower ureteric pathology. Okay. Suppose the ureter was not dilated. Then what else you could have done? Or your investigation would have been same plain CT.
This is a case of a bilateral multicystic disease, and as patient has already has a compromised renal function, sir. So I would like to treat the patient according to his bother of the symptoms, sir. And try to reduce the pain.
Suppose the report is that bilateral cystic kidneys, and right side there is a hydronephrosis. No comment about the hydroureter. So what can be the inference?
So would I also like to know the any whether there is any surrounding perinephric region, whether any there is any collection is there, fat stranding
okay,
is there, fat
All
stranding
right.
is there.
So there is no collection. Fat stranding doesn't come in the ultrasound. It is via ultrasound. How can you have fat stranding in ultrasound? But there is no collection on the ultrasound on the perinephric collection. What I meant to ask you is that in a polycystic kidney, how do you differentiate whether it is a cyst or whether it is a dilated collection on ultrasound?
Connection between the cyst and the pelvic LCL systems are in the dynamic films.
Right. So when you want to diagnose hydronephrosis, dilated PCS system, you have to see actually not the static picture, but you have to see the dynamic, you have to see yourself and then see whether whatever cysts which are appearing, whether they are connected to each other or not. If they are connected, then yes, that is to be diagnosed as pelvic collection system. Okay. So, all right. So, in this case, the CT scan is done. So, these are the CT plates. Okay, so what do you think?
In this, sir, there are bilateral cystic kidney disease with the right side upper uretic stone, and there are multiple cysts in the liver also, sir.
Bilateral cystic kidney when?
Right side upper uretic stone, sir.
And okay. There is small calculi in the lower calyx also, sir.
All right.
In the lower pole of the kidney.
This one.
Yes.
Okay, so what next you want to do? What next?
You see symptomatic on the right side. So we want to see the stone Hounsfield unit and the size of the stone.
Right kidney, multiple cysts, pieces of SIP identified, dilated upper uretric stone, single, 9 mm by 6 mm, HUA is 12, 1267, and these are all multiple calcifications in the cyst wall. What you are seeing, these stones, actually they are cyst wall calcification. Left there is nothing, bladder normal. So single upper uretric stone, hydronephrosis.
Yes, sir.
So what will you do? Symptomating on the right side. I will also renal function is on the borderline. I would like to save the function on the right side by removing the upper uretric stone. Ureteroscopic guiding intervention. I would like.
So you think that once you remove the stone, this function will come back to normal?
No, sir, but I would like to save the what as it is acutely started, so it's likely to be a right side kidney more functioning, and with the obstruction, that function also gone. So I would like to save that right side whatever function is remaining.
Okay, no, patient is asking that what is the guarantee that my creatinine will improve and will remain normal after surgery? I'm willing to undergo surgery. But how will you counsel him that, okay, your creatinine is 4.3, now you want to save the kidney. So he is quite happy that you want to save kidney. But what is the guarantee that eventually everything will become okay?
Sir, I will like to explain regarding the natural progression of this bilateral multicystic kidney, and he will eventually maybe land up in the end stage kidney also. Still he reaches the end stage kidney disease, I would like to save the function of the kidney by removing the stone and by applying the renoprotective strategy till that. At the end, I will also explain him regarding the renal transplantation if he goes into the end stage renal failure.
Okay, you agree with him, Praveen?
No, sir. Sir, slightly I would like to differ, sir. The patient in this acute condition of 4.3 creat, I would just like to try putting in a stent, DJS,
okay,
and repeat creatinine and see whether it is coming down.
Okay.
And once the nadir level is reached and his acute condition is settled down, then I would counsel the patient that this is his nadir creatinine. And because the stone was obstructing, I would first like to clear the stone and then counsel him that this is his nadir creatinine, and he would land up in future in end-stage renal disease as is having bilateral multicystic polycystic kidney disease, other polycystic.
Okay, so basically you want to be in a two-stage. First, you want to just put a DJ,
yes,
see the creatinine, and then only you take up for the surgery.
Sir.
Okay, so now I want to ask you, why you want to put a DJ as a first stage and then second stage surgery? Why not? He has no problem. He has no fever. Urine is sterile. There is no pyuria. His creatinine is 4.3. He has got a pain, but there is no fever. So what is this? What do you mean by the acute condition is to be settled? What is the problem? What is his acute? He has no acute condition. What do you mean by acute condition?
His creatinine is increased. And he is having a low hemoglobin also, and he had had an episode of hematuria also. So
that
all
is
this
hematuria is just occasional blood tinge.
Yes, sir.
Hemoglobin is 9.5.
Yes, sir. So in the region of ureter also there would be a lot of inflammation and this thing, because it is an obstructed system with hydronephrosis. So
okay.
I would like to stage the patient.
All right. So I won't quarrel with that. Both answers I will accept, that if you can go ahead with the first stage, I mean the straight away ureteroscopy also is acceptable. And as you justified that this is the reason you want to do two stage, this is acceptable. I mean, there's no harm in putting a double J stent, trying to find out how much creatinine comes down, and you can convince the patient that, okay, at least this much will come down, and then you can do that. Both answers is perfectly acceptable. All right. Now, I want to put the other scenario. Suppose everything is same. Polycystic kidney, completely asymptomatic, no pain, nothing. And you find that on one side, there is a 1.5 centimeter lower calyceal stone with all reports same. No urinary infection, no pain, 4.3 creatinine is asymptomatic. And just as a detection of ultrasound, you find that there is a 1.5 centimeter lower calyceal stone, and CT scan confirms that there is a lower calyceal stone. Now, what will be your approach?
So, in this patient, I would do a percutaneous procedure. Percutaneous.
You want to do PCNS?
PCNS.
Okay. Okay, Darshan.
Sir, I would like to explain him regarding the as the with 15 mm stone there is no complication as such, and with the 4.3 creatinine he will end up in the end stage renal failure in the 4 to 5 years. So doing a surgery on the already compromised kidney will not benefit him much regarding the creatinine level and his natural progression. So I will like to differ from doing the PCNS.
So you will just not do anything. You will keep under observation,
yes,
right?
Yes.
So now coming back to Praveen, why,
yes,
you want to do PCNL in this case? He's saying that it is not causing any problem. There is no hydronephrosis. As such, his creatinine is 4.3. He's going to progress.
But
so
he is having right flank pain.
No, I'm giving you the asymptomatic patient.
Asymptomatic patient.
Yeah, asymptomatic. So, question is, asymptomatic patient incidentally detected renal stone.
Yes.
Will you do PCNL or not?
I would counsel the patient that is his forming a stone. So there will be chances that he might form more stones, and if the stone size increases or there is more formation of stone, his kidney function will be compromised even further. After counseling, we can go ahead and do a surgery.
All right. Okay. So that is what is the answer. That so how you have to answer this question or how you manage such problems in the practice is that if it is a lower calcium stone, completely asymptomatic, with this creatinine, you need to understand what is the natural history of the polycystic kidney. Now, if the natural history of the polycystic kidney is that it is going to go going to progress to ESRD, then by doing surgery, you are not giving any benefit of saving the kidney, because it is immaterial whether it is whether you do surgery or whether you remove the stone or not. It is going to progress naturally to ESRD stage. The question of the stone causing complication, as we know that any stone, irrespective whether it is in the normal kidney or whether it is in the polycystic kidney, any stone, if you keep under observation over a period of time, it is going to become symptomatic. There is no question about it. Any stone, if you follow up for 5 years, 10 years down the line, they are likely to become symptomatic and cause some sort of a complication. That is a evidence-based medicine. So you have to see as to what is going to happen to this patient 5 years and 10 years down the line. So important thing in this case is that to see what is his likelihood of the renal replacement therapy. Suppose patient at present is asymptomatic. And obviously he is 4.3, so maybe a time is going to come where he is going to be dialysis dependent. Whether he is the candidate for transplantation or not, or whether he is a candidate for dialysis, that is what you have to see. If he is going to be a candidate for transplantation, then obviously he needs treatment, because you don't want to undergo or treat this stone or remove the kidney just because he is for transplantation. If it is a stone with the polycystic kidney, then you have to take out that kidney before transplantation. Okay, so that is one important point which you have to consider what is likely to happen in future. And as you rightly pointed out, that if his creatinine is say borderline, 4.3 actually is not a good creatinine. With 4.3, he is actually shortly he may progress to the renal failure. But say if you detect the patient say at 2 or 2.5 or like that, then definitely needs surgery, because it may be about 5 years, 6 years for him to become dialysis dependent, and during that time the stone can become symptomatic and can cause problems. So this is how you need to understand. Okay, so now the stone is removed, everything is fine, his creatinine actually came down. But over a period of time, it is going to progress. So you have explained about that. Suppose he comes back, maybe after 3 years later. Now, asymptomatic, but now creatinine is high and he has started on the dialysis. Suppose this patient now, say at the age of 55 years, he is for transplantation. How will you prepare this patient for transplantation? He had a ureteric stone which you treated 3 years back. Now 3 years later, he is dialysis dependent, 55 years of age, hypertension which is controlled, bilateral polycystic kidney, and now he wants to undergo transplantation. So how will you prepare this patient for transplantation? And first thing is that who can be the donor?
I will go with the basic recipient workup, and he is fit for the transplant. I will look for the donor, and I will prefer a non-blood related donor like his wife if blood group match. And if blood group is not matching, then I will like to make a list of siblings who are more than 30 years, at least 30, more than 30 years of age. And then try to look for the USG by any cyst is present in the kidney or not. And if by if there is any donor with more than 50 year and no cyst, then we can rule out any polycystic kidney disease, and we can safely remove one kidney without fear of having him any cystic disease.
Okay, good. All right. Suppose he has a donor who is not more than 30 years. He is a 29 years. That is the only donor in the family who is available. So what do you do then?
We'll do a scan and see whether he's having any cyst or not.
Okay.
And at the same time, if he's not having any cyst, we will counsel the family that the patient is not having any cyst. And even after they are insisting that to rule out autosomal dominant polycystic, we can do a genetic screening and see.
So if the CT scan shows there are no cysts, yes, then can you accept him as a donor at 29 years?
Yes, sir. Because within 1 year he might develop a maximum cyst, might be a one cyst like that. So even greater than 30 years with one cyst is acceptable candidate for the.
No, that's not acceptable criteria for the donor. If you have to take the donor which is less than the cutoff age, the CT scan cannot be implemented as a criteria for accepting and rejecting. Rejecting, yes, if he has got cyst, obviously he is rejected. But you cannot take a donor just on the CT scan criteria if the age is less than 30 years. It is mandatory to have the genetic study. So unless and until genetic study is done, the donor in the family cannot be accepted, especially sibling. If you have the parent, you know, from whose side who's from mother's side or father's side, if it has come, and then if you have a parent who is available on the other side, or parent's brother or father's brother, and if it has come from mother, then obviously those are acceptable, there is no problem. But if you have to take the sibling, then definitely less than 30 years of age, it has to undergo genetic testing. You cannot do, even if the CT scan shows no cyst, does not rule out that he will not have any cyst in the later life. It is possible that it is not cyst are not there today, but 5 years down the line, you can have the cyst. And then eventually it can progress to ESRD and then polycystic kidney. So which are the diseases which will so slowly progress? You said it is a autosomal dominant, no?
Yes.
Yes.
So are there any varieties which will progress fast and other will progress slow?
There are type 1 and type 2. Type 1 is basically the aggressive type of cystic disease, and type 2 is a slowly progressive disease. And the chances of ESRD are very late in the type 2.
Correct. So it could still be a type 2 variety which will form the polycystic kidney. And if you take out the kidney as a donor, then it is going to be a problem. So it is definitely you need to do a genetic study to collect to consider the a donor. Now coming back to the question that how will you prepare? Suppose now donor is there. Now, how will you prepare this patient for surgery? Any additional testing you want to do apart from the usual recipient workup? Any additional thing related to the polycystic kidney?
The size of the cyst is mentioned. If it is very large, then accordingly we plan, sir, a native nephrectomy is required or not.
Okay, right. So if it is coming into the, if your space is not there, then that side nephrectomy, okay, that is one preparation. Anything else?
Sir, any aneurysm in the brain, I would like to rule out. Okay. And heart condition also I would like to check. Sir, in the less than 60 year, I would like to go ahead with the MRI brain to look for any aneurysm is there. And according to size, I will manage that first before.
Why you want to rule out aneurysm in the brain? Every case you want to prepare?
Sir, in less than
every case of transplant, you want to do MRI brain?
No, sir. With a polycystic kidney and a younger patient, like 52 years, I would like to rule out the aneurysm, sir. In more than 60 years, it is not required, sir.
Okay. Why it is like that?
Sir, as a if aneurysm is large, like more than 4 or 5 mm, there are chances of rupture is there, and so like to manage that also with
Okay.
the same things.
All right. So, for example, if you want to undertake any major surgery, then it is better that you rule out the aneurysm in the intracranial aneurysm. Okay. So, coming back to the question, that what are the other different conditions which are associated with polycystic kidney?
So there might
you
be
said one is
hepatic
that
cyst.
Aneurysm.
Hepatic cyst and pancreatic cyst. In this patient, there is hepatic cyst also. I would like to see the liver function test.
No, no, that is okay. So that hepatic cysts are is a part and parcel of the cystic disease. Which are the other diseases which are associated with this?
Mitral valve disease.
What is
intracranial
prolapse.
Aneurysm?
Left
what
ventricular hypertrophy, mitral valve prolapse.
Okay.
Congestive cardiac failure.
Right. Okay. Diverticular formation. Okay. All right. So these are the condition which you can have the rupture of aneurysm is one of the problem which can be can manifest. They can have subdural hematoma. Why they can have subdural hematoma?
No, rupture of Berry aneurysm, small.
No, Berry aneurysm is different.
Arachnoid hemorrhage.
Subdural hematoma. You have aneurysm, it can rupture. That's okay. That is the intracerebral hemorrhage. But they also are liable to have the subdural hematomas.
Subdural veins due to raised intracranial pressure and hypertension, they can rupture.
Yeah. So one of the there are two reasons. One is that because of the hypertension, and sometimes the hypertension can be really very severe and uncontrolled. That can cause the increased intracranial tension and subdural hematoma. The other thing is that there can be cyst in the subdural space that can rupture and then that can cause hematoma. All right. So these are the things which are likely to happen. Okay. Anything else? Special preparation. One is said that if it is coming in the way, you do the nephrectomy. One is that to rule out intracranial aneurysm. Anything else? Heart and all, everything that is routine checkup as a part of every transplant, it is done. Anything special?
The condition of the vessels, sir, will do anastomosis. 51 year old with ADPKD.
So, what is the problem in ADPKD?
Hypertensive also. So,
so that every transplant, every recipient is hypertensive, every recipient is, has this problem. I'm asking you special problem of polycystic kidney when you are working up for transplant. Is there any special problem apart from what you have described? Any problem?
No idea, sir.
What are the problems in the ADPKD which can occur? Can they have the more incidence of renal cell carcinoma? Can they have more incidence of stone?
So incidence of renal cell carcinoma is the same, sir.
It's
in
same,
a normal
correct.
Individual and
okay.
Or,
what about the stone? What about stone?
If the kidneys, ADPKD kidneys already forming the stone, then it becomes an indication for nephrectomy. Otherwise,
ADPKD, if is there any increase in incidence of stone formation in a polycystic kidney or it is same as normal population?
And there are chances of sir, calcium oxalate stone forming increased in uric acid stone in the ADPKD patients. Sir.
Why?
So there is a this cyst where they are formed are they have a calcium channel sensing receptors there. So those are that is.
Polycystic kidney, patients, there is a 20% increase in the formation of a stone as compared to normal population. That's because the cyst itself can cause the obstruction to the PC system, which can lead to the increased stasis and then stone formation. Because so this cyst can press on some calyx, it can press on the puja, it can press on the ureter, it can press on the upper calyx, impedibulum, anywhere. And the stasis there can cause the stone. So there is a 20% increase in the chances of formation of a stone. Suppose there is a stone, as you said, that we discussed about 1.5 centimeter stone in the lower calyx. Suppose his kidney is functioning, what are the options of treating the stone? Can you do RIRS? Can you do PCNL? Can you do ESWL? 1 centimeter stone in the renal pelvis, 1000 HU.
RIRS would be better with the 1000 HU, sir. And
One centimeter.
ESWL, we cannot do ESWL as cyst in between will hamper the efficiency of ESWL. And
So is polycystic kidney contraindication for ESWL?
chances of rupture and hemorrhage are increased with the ESWL. So we
No,
should avoid.
is it a
Relative control.
contraindication?
No,
Yes
sir.
or no?
No, sir.
No, it is contraindication
Yes, sir.
because if you see how ESWL work, ESWL has to travel from the socket to the kidney to the stone. And if you have multiple interfaces in between, the shockwave delivery is not going to be proper. The shockwaves are going to get dispersed out. And therefore, there is not going to be efficiency of the breakage. At the same time, the shockwave reaching to the stone are improper, and in between when the shockwaves are traveling, there is possibility that they may damage the cyst in the this, and then that can have the rupture of the cysts. Okay, so ESWL is not to be preferred in not to be done in the polycystic kidney. What are the problems of RIRS in a polycystic kidney? What is
So
a
one more.
spider leg sign in the polycystic kidney? If you do IVP in a normal creatinine, what is spider leg sign?
The pelvis and the communicating cyst with the renal pelvis, pelvic Alveolar system.
No, cysts are never
That forms a.
communicated to.
Thin parenchyma in
No,
between
sir,
the
it looks.
cysts will look
Yes.
like legs of a spider.
Little.
No, not thin parenchyma. It is because of the multiple cysts. The chalices and infundibula, they are stretched
Yes.
because kidney gets enlarged and you have a stretching of the infundibuli and chalices, and therefore they appear like a spider leg. That is called a spider leg appearance. And what is the relevance of this is that when you want to do RIRS, the infundibuli and the chalices are so long that sometimes it is almost impossible to reach the calyx. Pelvis, it is okay, but to angulate that and reach deep into the calyx because of the stretched infundibuli and chalices, sometimes the flexible ureteroscopy becomes very difficult. So this is a thing which you have to remember as a point of technique. What are the problems in PCNL? Suppose if you want to do a PCNL, what are the problems? How do you puncture and how do you avoid the cyst?
If the stone is overlying the cyst, sir, then
The stone is in the pelvic Alveolar system, or say, for example, stone is in the lower calyx. So you are
yes,
not
sir.
able to do RIRS, and the only choice left over is the PCNL.
Yes,
So
sir.
how do you?
The calyces adjacent to where there is no cyst, we will try to puncture that. And if it is accessible to the stone, we will try to puncture that. Otherwise, if the cyst is coming in between, we will puncture the cyst, we will drain the cyst, and then we can do a PCNL.
So drain means what? You will put a tube in that, or how will you drain? Will you
No, sir.
drain
Through the
beforehand, or you
PCN
will take
only.
on the table? So
No,
will
so
you
on
do
the
that
table, on the same
on
sitting.
table,
Yes.
same sitting? So first you will puncture the cyst, drain the cyst,
Yes, and
and
through
then
that
puncture the
cyst.
PC system.
Yes.
Okay, so that is your method. Darshan, you agree with him?
Sir, I don't think, sir, draining of cyst is important, but finding the exact puncture is difficult as a cyst fluid will confuse with the urine. So I would like to use the colored methylene blue slightly in the RGC, so we can
Okay.
exactly target the calicilla and confirm the position of the needle.
Okay, all right. So remember one thing, that when you are doing PCNL in a polycystic kidney, you have to do PCNL like any other case. If there are cysts in the way, just ignore those cysts. Even if those, there are multiple cysts, if they are coming in the way, when you are puncturing, even if the cysts get punctured, or if cyst does not get punctured, it is immaterial. You target the stone, target the pelvic lateral system like any other case. Just don't bother about the cyst. It is possible there are multiple cysts may come in the way, and during dilatation, during puncture, some of the cysts may get ruptured. It is immaterial whether they get ruptured, where that fluid will go. That fluid will come into the tract and eventually that will disappear. So this is the point of technique which you have to remember, that the cysts have to be ignored while puncturing the pelvic lateral system. And as you rightly pointed out, you can put some methylene blue at this just to identify it is okay. That's perfectly all right. All right. Okay. So coming back to the transplantation, that you have tested for the preparation which we wanted to discuss it out, is that in every case of polycystic kidney, if we come for transplantation, it is necessary to do plain CT scan. Otherwise, as a recipient workup, we don't do plain CT scan in every case. But in this case, a polycystic kidney, NCCT is important. Why it is important as a transplant special workup? Why it is relevant?
To assess the space for the
No,
transplant
space,
tissue.
so you have palpated and that is different. You are not going to assess space by CT scan. That is by clinical examination.
Sir, any missed mass as a USG? In USG, it is difficult to pick up the mass with the.
Any missed mass,
Yes.
okay, but missed mass NCCT is of no use. If it is a mass you have to identify, then it has to be contrast enhanced CT scan.
Any lesion
Are
at least
you?
we can identify and try to remove the kidney if there is any lesion.
No, it is not like that. Lesion, if it is a lesion, then you have to be sure what is that lesion. It is not just some lesion is there, so you just take it out. How do you know that what lesion it is? Suppose NCCT show that there could be some lesion. It may be there, it may not be there. It's a waste of doing surgery unnecessarily. Suppose NCCT shows there is some lesion, query lesion on the right side. What will you do?
Sir, if patient is on dialysis, then I will try to look for with the contrast enhanced CT and the dialysis followed. I would try to characterize, but try to avoid unnecessary. Yes.
Yeah, so just because something is seen doesn't mean that you do nephrectomy. You can always do a contrast enhanced CT scan, see whether that mass is enhancing or not. If that is not enhancing, it is definitely not the malignancy at all. But at the same time, every case you don't have to do a contrast enhanced CT scan. Okay, but plain CT definitely is required. Why is that?
So the calcium one
As
is
a part
the
of
calcium.
workup, as a part of workup.
Yes, one to see the calcification in the vessel. Second is the whether the cystic part is compressing the major vessels.
No, which major vessel?
The aorta vena cava, if it is compressing only.
No. Cyst can, the polycystic can never compress aorta. Aorta or nothing can compress aorta.
Sir,
Where is the question of aorta? Polycystic
characterize
kidney
the
is a different thing.
fluid in the cyst if there is any echoes and sorry any pus or collection is there in a cyst, then we need to remove or that side of the kidney.
Yeah, correct. So that is the correct reason that why you want to do is that you want to see the if there are any multiple cysts which has got blood, which has got pus, whether there is any calcification, then you have to keep that in mind, even if the patient is completely asymptomatic. And if you see on one side there is too many calyces are likely to be blood or there is a clot because he has got off and on the hematuria. So it is likely that this can be a problem. And then you can consider the doing that side nephrectomy in case if that is found significant on the CT scan. So what I mean to say is that the special preparation when you are preparing the patient as a recipient in a polycystic kidney that you need to consider all these factors. Okay. All right. So then coming back to this transplantation, apart from the donor, any other problem you anticipate when you are doing transplant in this case? Everything is prepared. You have prepared the patient, donor is there. Any specific problem you anticipate just because it is a polycystic kidney?
No, no.
No, yes.
Anything? No. The only problem which you anticipate is that polycystic kidneys are more prone for causing hypertension, which is a renin-induced hypertension. And therefore, even though hypertension is properly controlled by medication, it is this has to be kept in mind that the blood pressure, like any other case of recipient, and the polycystic kidney, the blood pressure has to be properly monitored. And in fact, in the previous era, one of the indications of doing nephrectomy was the uncontrolled hypertension. That was the previous indication. Of course, now there are multiple drugs which are available, and the blood pressure can definitely be controlled by medication. So that indication now no longer remains. But this was the major indication for doing the nephrectomy pre-transplant. So, what are the indications of pre-transplant nephrectomy?
Uncontrolled pain, recurrent UTIs, or any malignancy, or kidney occupying the larger side of larger area in the abdomen.
Stone, any
So,
stone.
okay.
When do you do bilateral nephrectomy? Any indication of doing bilateral nephrectomy?
Uncontrolled hypertension.
Uncontrolled hypertension.
Uncontrolled, we have just said that it is now hardly an indication because there are so many good drugs are available that you can always control the blood pressure. Nowadays, very rarely you need bilateral nephrectomy for that. Is
Patient is
bilateral
having
nephrectomy
bilateral recurrent side, both side pain and infections, recurrent episodes
Yeah,
of
so whatever can happen on the one side can happen on both sides. Rupture of the cyst, bleeding
Yes.
from the one side, pain, bilateral stones, recurrent infection on both sides, obstruction on both sides. These are all indications for bilateral pre-transplant nephrectomy. If you want to do bilateral pre-transplant nephrectomy, when will you do pre-transplant nephrectomy? Is it during recipient transplant surgery or it is a planned surgery before? And how long before? And what are the problems?
It is a deep controversy, but generally they prefer doing the same sitting with the transplant, but it will increase the time of the operation and the post-op morbidity. And by doing the pre-transplant bilateral nephrectomy, it will cause the fluid overload and the problem with the heart and the hyperkalemia and uncontrolled electrolytes. So we have to balance this, but we prefer doing on the same sitting with the transplants if the single side nephrectomy is there.
Okay, Praveen, what do you think?
Sir, based on the preference of the surgeon, sir. One is,
No, you are the surgeon. You are the surgeon. What is your preference?
sir, on the same sitting, sir. Same
Same
sitting
sitting.
to avoid the complication of volume overload and congestive cardiac failure.
Okay,
That's.
now let me clarify that doing bilateral nephrectomy at same sitting of transplant is extremely hazardous. Polycystic kidney nephrectomy itself takes time. The problem of polycystic kidney, what is the problem of this nephrectomy, is that there is an extensive dissection which is involved. That is number one. After nephrectomy, there is a huge raw area which remains, which is likely to have the bleeding, which is likely to have the serous collections and things like that. So complications are there, which are added to the post-transplant situation. The after bilateral nephrectomy, because of the extensive dissection, there is lot of paralytic ileus for the variable period of time, whichever method you do. And therefore, bilateral nephrectomy along with the transplant is not recommended. It has to be done beforehand. The problem what you have mentioned of fluid overload, electrolyte imbalance, potassium, and all those things,
Dialysis can.
with the modern dialysis, managing a nephric patient is not a big issue. It was a big issue 20 years back. But now, with the kind of modern dialysis which we have, nephrologists are extremely happy without any problem to manage a nephric patient. And therefore, if you want to do bilateral nephrectomy, it is better that you do it about 8 to 10 days before a date of transplantation. Why? Because whatever complications, whatever side effects, or whatever things which are going to happen will happen about 4 or 5 days after surgery. And therefore, that much gap has to be kept. And once the patient recovers from that, there is going to be paralytic ileus, there could be some bleeding from the drain site, and all those things can happen. Now, if you do all these things and the patient is immunosuppressed and your surgery lasts for so many hours, your transplant is in jeopardy. And therefore, when you take the patient for transplantation, he has to be absolutely in a condition to be to have this with minimum complications. If you have all these complications, then post-transplant it is very, very difficult to manage. Suppose if he gets collection, it's difficult to manage after transplantation with the immunosuppression present. If you have the transplant complications in addition to the recipient, the donor, I mean the nephrectomy complications, these are all unnecessary additional problems. Managing a nephric patient is far more easier than doing a bilateral nephrectomy simultaneously with transplant. Okay, so that is the answer which you have to give, and that is what we also practice in our institute. I think most of the institutes will follow this protocol if at all you want to do bilateral nephrectomy. All right, I think that's it for the others. If you have any questions, please go ahead and ask. Otherwise, we can stop.
No, sir.
All right. Okay. So thank you, Praveen, and thank
Thank
you.
you. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Darshan. All right.